The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
Tonight, we're talking about our favorite fantasy games.
This is a bit of a follow-up to episode 231, The Final Frontier, which we released earlier this year back in February. And there we were talking about our favorite sci-fi games.
So check out that episode if you want to follow, hear about my favorite genre of games.
So let's get things started with a quick, at least I assume this one will be quick. I don't think it'll be like talking about classic games, but a bit of a discussion on what we think when someone says fantasy games. Because while fantasy can be pretty broad, and while some sci-fi is more fantasy than science, especially the one with the space wizards and laser swords. When I hear fantasy, though, I don't think of that. Like, yes, I could probably agree to the argument that it's sci-fantasy or something. But like when someone says fantasy to me, I think dragons, elves, dwarves. I think Tolkien and Dungeons and Dragons. Now, I also think there are types of fantasy that are kind of subgenres that I don't know if always fit when you're talking fantasy. Like for me, I don't think urban fantasy when I think fantasy. Like urban fantasy is a thing, totally a genre. I totally get it and I understand its appeal. But if you say fantasy board game, I don't think urban fantasy board game. Things like Changeling, Charles DeLint fit that urban fantasy thing. And I also really don't think horror mashes well with fantasy, though there, of course, can be horrific fantasy. So there's that bit of overlap. But like you mentioned, vampires and zombies. Even if I'm playing Ravenloft in D&D, I still feel you're now playing a horror campaign as opposed to a fantasy campaign.
But what about elves and cyberpunk?
See, again, to me, that's cyberpunk. That's transhumanism more than fantasy, especially since in that particular game, everyone was human first and then goblinized into fantasy races. And while I do like the trick, cute nod that dragons are CEOs, I do like that.
Yeah, I didn't even actually know that. I've despised that game so much. I've never actually knew that everyone was human and then turned into fantasy races.
Yes, it's called, the process was called goblinization.
See, I would argue urban fantasy is still fantasy, but I can't think of any board games that I'd park under that umbrella anyway, so I'm going to give it to you. I'll let you have it. I'm not going to argue too hard.
The only thing, the big license I can think of that's been in various types of games that fits that would be Dresden Files. And then you've got the White Wolf stuff, right? The mage in particular is not horror the way werewolf or werewolf's not totally horror either. But like compared to vampire, I would say mage and Dresden Files are the one there.
Okay, but I was going specifically board games. And well, there's a Dresden File board game. There's no White Wolf board games that I...
There are multiple. They just none of them were ever got a lot of hype. I just
don't know about them. Never mind then.
They never got a lot of hype. RPG companies don't seem to be all that great at producing popular board games.
When I think of urban fantasy, I suppose it all kind of depends. Like the movie Bright is definitely fantasy. Like that falls into fantasy. There are elves and
fae. There's your Shadowrun.
And it's Shadowrun-y, but it's definitely they are different races. Certainly they are converted humans. That one falls into both urban fantasy and proper fantasy, I think. I say the question that you run into on this topic is whether or not you are thinking of that medieval, and I use that in quotes, sort of vibe, the fake medieval historical feel to it, fantasy versus modern fantasy. And I think in our case, we're talking generally about the more quote unquote historical fantasy styles generally.
That's definitely where my mind went. Like I thought Deanna might be full on urban fantasy. If there's fae and Feywild and magic, then it's fantasy. I wasn't sure if we were all on the same page here.
That way. I just don't think I couldn't think of any board games that fell in there. So I'm like, I'm not going to argue too hard.
Now I did look up Board Game Geek since they're considered, you know, the expert repository on board game knowledge. They claimed fantasy games are those that have themes and scenarios that exist in a fictional world. I'm like, okay, that's pretty dang broad. It's a genre that uses magic and or other supernatural forms as a primary element to plot, theme, or setting. That, I think, sticks out. Like that I thought was pretty interesting. The fact that there has to be supernaturality or magic for it to be fantasy, and I did like that. Fantasy is generally distinguished from science fiction and horror by the expectation it steers clear of scientific or macabre themes. Fair enough. Though these can be a great deal of overlap between the three. Now, it talks about elements found in a fantasy game, and I'm not sure if I agree with this one as much. This seems like it was written by, like, Wargamers or something years ago and never edited. but creatures that are common in fantasy books and comics, such as orcs, trolls, goblins, and dragons, magic that can be used with units or abilities, and can involve a struggle between good and evil. Like, that's C1. Like there has to be a struggle between good and evil forces for it to be fantasy?
That's a bit of a...
Might, but still, it's an odd one to feel the need to...
But I totally agree with that whole, there has to be magic or supernatural forms. Like, I almost wonder if you took, like, here's an example, Battle Lore. The original Battle Lore is just the War of the Roses, or was it the Hundred Year War? It's one of the two. I forget which right now. It's not important to this particular topic, but it's a historical battle and historical units with historical forces on historical maps, and everything's historic, but they themed it all fantasy. Like, it's actually dwarves versus goblins. Instead of, I think it's the French versus the English. But there was no reason for it to be fantasy. And at that point, I'm like, it's a historic game with special looking minis. But then they added in a rule for magic so that on every die, there's a symbol that has a magic symbol. And you get to put those on a little cup and you can spend them to do special things. And in a historic game, that would probably just be like command points or something, or represent your leaders pushing your units harder. But by throwing that in, I think it really does make Battle Lore a fantasy game, even though it's like a pure historic war game otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about Stratego a lot lately for various reasons, and you can really easily just, you know, put a different figure on your Stratego and call it fantasy. But I don't think it is until you take it and do some of the re-themes that we talked about during our Stratego episode, where they actually took the concept of Stratego and turned it into a Lord of the Rings game.
Yes.
Without just painting over the figures.
Now, fairy tales in general, I assume that's fantasy. I don't see how it wouldn't be. Like, to me, that's kind of in between in folklore and mythology. I think all of those fit under fantasy just as well. Like, it doesn't have to be elves and dwarves. It can be Achilles and Trojan horses.
Yeah, I think totally. People are talking in the chat about Norse gods, and I think as much, you know, the Norse fairy tales, for the lack of a better term, are just as much fairy tales as tales of the Fae from the Celtic legends.
Yep. And then the one I'm on the fence about, and normally I'd say sci-fi, is steampunk. And the only reason I'm on the fence is D&D put out an extremely popular setting called Eberron that is very much steampunk, with lightning rails and airships and robot characters. And I think most people still consider it fantasy, but is that just because it's D&D?
I think that's because it's D&D. To me, that's right in there. That's pushing you right into sci-fi because you have added the science of flight and mechs. And whether it's steam or not, you know, steam or electric, it's still science.
Steampunk is just Victorian setting sci-fi. In my mind, like that's
like, to me, it's Victorian cyberpunk. Like, that's exactly what it is. But then I guess it's Victorian Shadowrun if you're looking at Eberron, because it's still D&D, right? You got your gnomes and dwarves and you're fighting dragons and doing all the D&D things. You just happen to also have Warforged in this very high tech-ish city. So it's all driven by magic. So that's you put in the science, but then you explain the science away as magic. They're trying to keep it fantasy.
Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So there we go.
Yeah. And the last one I was thinking about was post-apocalyptic. And normally I'd say, no, hell no, definitely not fantasy. But I have seen, especially in the 70s and 80s, many post-apocalyptic movies where the remains of humanity, obviously based on the idea of that generic German, French, English medieval time period where you're back to knights, except now they're on motorcycles.
Unless you're going with the fantasy creatures, fantasy magic, if you're just going a little, you know, bringing it back historically again, but with motorcycles, I don't call that fantasy. Now, I think there have been some out there where they do bring in the magic, you know, magic resurges after the apocalypse, then you're getting into fantasy. But even then, again, it depends on where they're falling on the use of science along with magic. And it can get a little questionable in there.
Right. Because you can have like telepathy and stuff and it's still sci-fi.
The psionics is an interesting one. Once you threw psionics in Dark Sun, does that make it a sci-fi setting? Technically, Dark Sun is a sci-fi setting. Because not only are there psionics, it's also post-apocalyptic. It's a world that was destroyed by magic, and you're dealing with the after effects.
Yeah, I mean, we get into the whole fact of, you know, again, Star Wars. Is it fantasy or is it science fiction or is it both? And really, it's both. I mean,
I call it science fantasy, right? Like, I think Star Wars is lacking is nowhere does Star Wars try to explain the science. They never explain what a warp drive is. They never explain anything, which is why I think it's more on the fantasy side, as opposed to, say, Battlestar Galactica, which may have some fantasy elements and maybe even a hero's journey. But they spend an awful lot of time explaining how things work.
Right. Yeah, I think the original concepts of Star Wars were fantasy, 100%.
Yeah,
I think it has drifted with other authors and things since then. But I think when you look at the first Star Wars movie, first movie, it's a fantasy movie. It's 100%.
If you get prequels, it's even more fantasy. There's like midichlorians and virgin births and stuff. It gets even wackier. So
yeah, that's true.
Anyways, back to board games.
I think I'm good. I think in general, I think this one we kind of all agree on, right? Like you need magic, you need elves and dwarves, and you need no science, I guess, as a hard and fast rule. Once you start throwing science in there, you're getting into steampunk or whatever. So I think we're all on the same page for this one. And I actually wasn't sure before we started this episode. So good to know. So I think at this point, we'll move on to talking about our favorite fantasy board games. And let's see if we mess up and name a game that doesn't fit what we just talked about.
Now, as usual, this list is in no particular order.
All right, I'm going to start with the biggest dungeon crawler we played in the biggest box and the heaviest game. And that is the cooperative game Gloomhaven from Cephalofair Games. We didn't even finish the game. I don't even know how far we are in. I felt like we were like just past halfway, but I don't know. But even with that, I think it's the game I put the most hours into that isn't a role-playing game. Because back in the day, we played an awful lot of Warhammer and AD&D and Cyberpunk and 12-hour sessions and stuff. But for board games, I think this is the game I've spent the most of my life playing. Is a fantastically detailed, rather heavy cooperative card management game in a unique fantasy world. And that world is part of why I want to call this one out, because what I like a lot about Gloomhaven is the world you're exploring, because it's not just your usual elves and dwarves and goblins. Now, we haven't tried Frosthaven. I haven't tried Bugs and Buttons, but I will stand by what we said in our Jaws of the Lion review. Even though I'm only putting Gloomhaven on the list, I think the main game is what deserves to be here. If you're going to get into Gloomhaven, start with Jaws of the Lion. That has not changed.
Yeah, Gloomhaven is one of the first ones that popped into my head as well. There's a lot of backstory going on, and you're playing in a very established world that has its own mythos and its own fantasy creatures like Vermlings and Inox. And to me, that makes it a really strong fantasy game.
Another thing I just thought of, too, is it kind of takes the heroic tropes that you find in most fantasy games and fantasy settings of you are the good guys and kind of twist that on its end. For anyone who played Gloomhaven, I was kind of shocked by the way the campaign starts. You are not the good guys in Gloomhaven. So going back to Board Game Geek's definition, I guess it's not a fantasy game because it doesn't qualify for number C.
Well, I think one of the interesting things that has appealed to me for Gloomhaven is that they don't rely on the standard fantasy creatures. It's not just orcs and goblins and trolls. They've gone their own direction with that.
All right. My first pick is Terra Mystica. I love this game. I have played it a ton. One of the things I love about Terra Mystica is the asymmetric factions. And those factions are built around fantasy tropes. We got mermaids, giants, halflings, witches, alchemists, dwarves, etc. The game could easily be rethemed. And I mean, they did turn it into a sci-fi version with Gaia Project, but it really shines as it stands.
See, this is one that like you say it, and I'm like, Terra Mystica. No, that's a Civ game. It's like an empire building game. It's engine building. I'm like, well, I guess those are fantasy races. Like, and you do have that pool of power you're moving. I guess that could be magic. But for some reason, that game just doesn't bring fantasy to my mind at all. But then you got the player boards in front of you with the pitchers and the way the giants play different than the halflings. And I'm like, I guess it's fantasy. I do like the game. It's a very solid game. It's one we need to get playing again. Props to Board Game Arena for making it very manageable and quick.
Yeah, no, it's one of those games that's absolutely 100% a fantasy game. But if you're not looking at it it doesn't necessarily, it's kind of that not painted on theme, but getting there. It's verging on that.
In, but it could easily be unlaced and retied somewhere
else.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So my first game is Clank, a deck building adventure. You're delving down into dungeons, but be careful to make too much noise, and you have that angry dragon to deal with. Good versus evil right there. And your fantasy monsters, can you escape with a loop? If you're lucky, the local town people might drag your rotting carcass back out of the dungeon. This is a great deck builder, variable market, and some fun randomization, making for a very reasonably quick dungeon adventure for beginner and more advanced dungeoneers. My family only has the base game, and we have yet to bore of it. But even if we did, there are a number of expansions, even without going to the, you know, Clank in Space and other versions that keep it in that fantasy realm and expand the options.
Yeah, that's a great choice. I completely forgot about Clank. It's like the essence of dungeon crawling. What's more typically fantasy than that?
Yeah, big Clank fan. Have been for a while. We have the first expansion, Sunken Treasure, which added things like flooded chambers and aqua monsters to go with it. I liked it because it added to the game without changing it too much, which to me is exactly what I want from an expansion like this. More cards in the market, more new things to buy. What I really want to do with Clank is try Legacy. Now, I know it's long out of print, hard to find, and I think there's a Legacy 2 coming, but that is something I would love to play through with the three of us. My next one is Tyrants of the Underdark, a Dungeons and Dragons mashup of units on a map and deck building. I adore this game, and I find it sad you don't hear anything about this game anymore. Like, they just did a new printing. I don't remember if it was last year or the year before. It includes the expansion content, which sadly was only ever one extra set of cards, which gave you two new decks to play. But they put this out. It's back on the market. It's at a cheaper price point than the original and comes with the expansions, and no one's talking about this. Now, I am personally bummed that the game didn't explode more. I would have liked to buy multiple different decks. Right now, it's all about the drow, but throw in some other races. I want a Smirf Neblin deck. Come on. Deep gnomes fighting it over in the Underdark. I think that would be fantastic. This game just seemed like it had plenty of room to expand, and I don't know why it didn't take off. The only thing I can think of is the D&D players wanted D&D-style combat with heroes and battling things, not a deck-building army game. And while the army players don't want this weird purple theme with these dark-skinned elves. That's the only thing I can think of.
Yeah, I had this one on my shortlist, but I crossed it out because somehow it just didn't feel fantasy to me. And I don't know why, because it's drow, it's Underdark, it's D&D. And I like the game. I enjoy the gameplay. I can't figure out, I was thinking about it critically and I just couldn't figure out why. I was like, no, not that one. I'm glad you ended up putting it in there. But and I do agree with you. I wish they had put out expansions and more content.
Yeah. Hashtag not my dark elves. this game, I can see the appeal. It just didn't hit with me. And I think there were various reasons why it didn't. But yeah, no, it's definitely a fantasy game. Just didn't end up being for me.
All right. Next up, I have Small World. And I think everyone is probably familiar with this one. It's actually not one of my favorite games of all time, but I think it's a classic. It probably should have been in last week's list. Again, we're looking at a bunch of asymmetrical player factions. And again, we've got all the fantasy tropes. Dwarves, elves, giants, halflings, orcs, trolls, sorcerers. And I feel like the theming is tied in pretty nicely. When you're playing Small World, folks aren't very likely to say, hey, the red dude's over there. They're going to be saying, those are the orcs, move the orcs, you know? So I feel like it's tied in tight enough, you know?
And I do love the whole mashup, right? You've got whatever the Bombardier, and you get Bombardier Halflings and Bombardier Trolls, and it actually changes up the way you play each race. And then the whole thing where you don't play one race for the entire game, which is also very unique, actually. I can't think of very many other fantasy games where you don't stick with, you know, the same characters from start to finish, or the same faction, at least. I'm a fan. We never actually owned the base game. Back when this game was popular, it was popular enough that enough locals had it that if I ever wanted to play it, I could. I do dig the app, though. That is actually my preferred way to play Small World on a tablet. It's a little small for the phone. If you are looking for that, though, it's weird because it's called Small World 2 due to a licensing hiccup when they first released it.
I fully nominate that app. It is actually what brought me from I don't care for Small World to I like the game.
Yeah, Small World is interesting. It's one of those games where there's probably a lot of people who don't know that Small World 2 is Small World 1. It's just, you know, say, oh, you know, Small World 2 is great. I wonder what the original one was like. No, it's the same thing. It's just
The original. It had to do with a different company putting out a game named Small World that wasn't based on the board game. That's all it is.
As usual. So my next one is Draconis Invasion. We haven't talked about this one in a little while, but this is a deck builder with a fixed market in the lineage of Dominion, but with some interesting bits added on. You're fending off invading armies of evil and trying to remain strong in the face of overwhelming hordes. Stand strong, slay the beasts to win, or just run terror if it gets to be too much. Now, this was a Kickstarter we previewed, and frankly was one of the few previews we've done that we actually kind of enjoyed. We didn't have constant complaints about component quality or lacking rule books and other things. Now, while I admit the Dominion style is not everyone's cup of tea, if you do enjoy deck builders, this game has a notable quantity of cards. It's 500 in the base set to vary up your setups and plays. And there are more on the way soon.
Yeah, it's a solid game. I know it's one of your favorites. I'm looking forward to checking out the expansions. Yeah, I wonder what could be in that box.
So the only thing I think Sean missed there that's pretty important for people who don't know the game, this is cooperative. This is a cooperative Dominion-style deck builder, which alone really makes it stand out versus games like Dominion. My next one is a big one, a big heavy one. That is Dungeon Lords from Czech Games Edition. Now, this game was not what I expected at all. It's one of the biggest examples of wrong expectations. I thought it was going to be a silly, light game, kind of like the video game Dungeon Keeper, you know, the one where you get to abuse your little goblin. And drop people into potions and stuff like that and sacrifice people. It's not that at all. Though the looks match, like the little goblin meeple kind of look like the goblin from Dungeon Keeper. And I think there was some intention there. The thing is, this is a rather heavy and punishing Euro game about building dungeons, dealing with invading heroes, keeping your monsters fed, keeping your dungeons from collapsing. And that's all things you have to manage at once. It's a little ridiculous. Now, it gets even heavier when you throw in the expansions, but it gets even better. It's just more of the awesomeness. If anyone is interested in checking this game out, look for the Happy Anniversary Edition. It has all of the expansion content as well as some promos and revised boards and things like that. This is a fantastic game. Wasn't at all what I expected, but I love it.
Yeah, this one I haven't tried yet.
Yeah, I love this game. Oh, Sean, you should try it. It has been way too long since we played it. And once you get over that whole mixed expectations hurdle, the game rocks.
Put it this way, I think it's heavier than any game we've introduced you to. There's literally, okay, so the side note, Squirrel. Well, not really, because I'm still talking Dungeon Lords. So one of the things Dungeon Lords does is it gives you a separate rule book that walks you through a tutorial for the first, say, three turns of the game. And it goes through an invasion of heroes and how best to manage your monsters to defeat these heroes and how to set things up. Well, the rule book literally says, now that you've played this, ask the other players if they still want to play the game. It is likely this game wasn't what they expected. I'm like, it literally in the rule book is like, yeah, you might not have been expecting this amount of brain burn. Check with your players if they're still interested in playing. They are, continue this way. I'm like, wow. At least the rule book set that expectation. Like reading it, I'm like, okay, this is going to be different. But man, when you get it down, the first play will probably be terrible. But once you get it, once you see it happen, once you see how it works and why you might want to, you know, not lure the heroes to your place right away, or why you might want to build something for turn six and turn one just in case, then it becomes fantastic.
All right. Next up, I've got Destinies. And I talked about this before. The settings for Destinies reminds me of this Amiga game that we used to play back in the 90s. It's like it's taking all the fantasy tropes of European Middle Ages Christian folklore and saying, okay, all of this is real. Prophecies, end of days, got angels, demons, witches, it's all real. You can go to a church, you can get blessed. You can kill a werewolf by melting down silver and making a weapon. You know, it just runs with that. And then I like the game because of the which way make a story. I like the game because of the which way make a choice story elements. We've only played once, but I really enjoyed it, and I can't wait to get it back to the table.
Now, one of the things that sets this apart from like a Witch Way that I loved is because the world would change. Like, if someone else's character got to the spot first and found the thing, I couldn't then go find it, right? That's where it kind of beats out other games with that kind of which way feel and why this is, like, wholly app-driven. Now, the video game Dana was alluding to on the Amiga was called Darklands, which is actually based on the Dark Eye, or Das Schwarze Auge, Germany's most popular role-playing game. Something that's going to come up a bit in a little bit later.
I felt like the app for Destinies wasn't like a gimmick.
No,
it actually really drove the heart of the game and allows you to have that developing world, which is super cool.
And I'm sure regular viewers already know what that next game that has just been hinted at will be. But up first, I'm not going there. I'm going with the one that started the franchise, the OG Valeria Card Kingdoms. So a tableau builder that's super easy to pick up, but with a huge range of replayability even before you start picking up the many, many expansions cards that add to the variability. You roll the dice and everyone gets to activate cards. You know, they've done it in space now with space and you know, Valeria is in there with the earlier fantasy theming of that. Activate your card, you know, choose what everyone gets to activate cards. Then you kill or hire. That's it. That's pretty much your whole game. Now, I do complain about the grammar of Duke cards, but as long as everyone agrees on how you read them, it's fine.
Yeah, it's Valeria Card Kingdoms is a great game. Like, I strongly feel like everyone should just try this game once at some point. Period. The end.
I know a few people, though, that don't like this game because of the resource glut. And honestly, the first time we played was at Origins at the Daily Magic booth, their first time ever at Origins, very purple booth with purple nerds. The designer was there and we learned the game from him and he explained his reasoning on why the game works this way and what he wanted out of it. And I probably would have complained about this if I hadn't. So for those that do find it odd, like you just pile up a ton of stuff by the end of the game, that's part of the game. It's supposed to feel like you hoarding wealth and having amassed and built something by the end. Think of yourself as, you know, a dragon on your hoard or the Duke sitting with their treasure room. That is supposed to be part of the game. You're supposed to have a pile of stuff left, which is why the Duke scoring is so important in that game. And why, if you read it wrong, it can really mess up your final score. My next one is Caverna the Cave Farmers from Mayfair Games originally. At least that's where my version comes from. I think Lookout Games is the current publisher. Now, this is one kind of like Terra Mystica that I tend to forget is fantasy. But because a big part of the game is farming, right? It's an Uwe Rosenberg farming game. It's the follow up to Agricola, right? You're farming and you're building your buildings and you're having kids and you're going and putting out animal pens and you got a dog that lives in your house, right? But the thing is, you're dwarves. That's not enough to make a fantasy meme. But a big mechanism in this game is you can send your dwarves down into the caves and they go on quests and you roll random rolls to see how far they get and they can bring up resources and they can battle things down there and level up and get better at delving next time. Now, I got to admit, this is pretty much on the top of the need to get it to the table again list, though actually our conversation a few minutes ago about Dungeon Lords might have put it ahead. The two of those are pretty up there on the, man, Sean hasn't gotten to try these. We need to play them with Sean as well as other people. To me, this is Uwe's best game. The only problem was I bought a box insert for it.
You are doomed to never play it again.
The real reason why Sean has never played Caverna.
Yep. That's the box insert curse. Is that Bellhop's law number four? If you build a box insert for a game, I can't say it'll never hit the table again, but it'll hit the table less often, even though that's not the point of a box insert.
If you build it, you won't play.
Yes, if you build it, you won't play.
Next up, I have Aventuria, which is a game we were hinting at that is based on the Dark Eye. It's a great fantasy setting. It's a little dark and grim at times and definitely not family friendly. It gives off Warhammer fantasy vibes. I love this game so much. I enjoy the mechanic where you need to decide which cards to turn into resources. And that's a choice that's become pretty popular right now. We're seeing it in CCGs like Star Wars Unlimited and Altered. But Aventuria was the first time I encountered the concept and I really dig it.
Was that in Altered? I know it was in Lorcana. I don't remember it being in Altered.
See, I... We only played Altered the one time, and yeah. I thought it also had something it similar. Might. And I thought they were like, this is our brand new thing that no one has ever done. And we were like, And then we sat down for the other demo for Star Wars, and they were like, this is the brand new thing that no one else has ever done. And we were like,
Yeah, this is the game, obviously, I alluded to earlier. This is the Dark Eye card game, translated to English, and we love it. Game is still supported. For some reason, hard to find in stores. I don't know why it's available. If anyone can't find it, just I'll send you a link. It's not hard to find like it was, but it still just doesn't show up on some of the usual channels. What looks awesome is they have improved the game recently, within the last year, where they've changed the campaign rules for character advancement and made it a little better than just I get to tick up one of my skills by one. And the newest adventures they're releasing for it finally have more of a branching path. Like if you fail here, go this way. If you succeed here, go this way. And the results of your skill checks don't just, you know, modify the start of the next battle. I am really looking forward to diving back into Adventuria. It's something we need to start doing again. Just need these eyes to get finally fixed up again.
You know, 80, I have an appointment on Friday. They're 80 some percent there. I so want to play the new stuff they put out in the last year.
Yeah, unfortunately, the only reason we stopped playing this was, you know, visual acuity issues. Otherwise, we would have kept playing this all the way through. 100%.
Probably.
All right, well, my next one is One Deck Dungeon. Now, I actually came to this game via the app first, before the board game. It's a roguelike dungeon crawler where the deck itself builds out the dungeon, but then becomes the loot with each victory. It's a simple enough dice placement system that makes it really easy to set up and then play again and again and again and again. And it has a fun leveling up system that means the more you play, the better your characters can get. This roguelike is actually more roguelike than many things that claim that title.
I've actually never tried this one.
So going back to the CG realm, so quite a while ago, they're still around, sorry, at their old location. I played a single deck based dungeon crawler, but I don't remember if it was this. It might have been 5-Minute Dungeon, which is another one I think was out at the time. And the problem I had with it is that it was single player only. I would always rather play with a group, and again, I'll play video games before I play a solo game. Is this solo, or is this
One Deck Dungeon is one or two, solo or two?
One player. Or two?
Yeah. And also, interestingly, they just dropped a new game on Board Game Arena, Mini Rogue, and I played a round of it, and I'm like, oh, this really wants to be One Deck Dungeon, but I'd rather be playing One Deck Dungeon. So
fair enough. My next one is another Dungeons & Dragons game, and that is Lords of Waterdeep. I, for one, dig the theme here. I know some people don't as much or feel it's superfluous. I don't know. I like the little D&D tie-ins, even though they are tenuous. I at least recognize names of places and people, and I still call them warriors and mages, even though they might just be red and blue cubes. More importantly, though, I love the gameplay in this game. I love the engine building. It's the same thing I liked in Endangered. I like worker placement games where you add more worker placement spots, and those worker placement spots are directly chosen by the players. That is just something I like in games, I've learned. I love the way you start off this game and there's, you know, four or five choices. They're not that big, and a couple are just get resources. But as the game goes on and people build more buildings, there's more options. I also love the stab you in the back mechanics from these Scoundrels of Skullport, part of the one expansion that was released. Like, this is a game I'm kind of shocked stopped there. I was really hoping for some more content for Lords of Waterdeep. And yeah, this is an older game, but if someone came up to me and said, hey, you want to play Lords of Waterdeep? I'm like, hell yeah, let's go.
Yeah, particularly once you mix in the expansion, I really dig this game. It has been a long time since we played it. I'll bring it out to the next public play event.
Yeah, I'm one who thinks it's very pasted on theme. It wasn't a bad game. It just had nothing to do with D&D as far as I was concerned.
All right. My next one is Fighting Fantasy Adventures, the board game from Martin Wallace based on the classic Fighting Fantasy game books from Steve Jackson and Ian Livingston. I loved Which Way game books like this when I was a kid, and I was very excited to see this back in board game form. We had the chance to check out a prototype version a while back, and I really enjoyed it. You lay cards out to form a dungeon map and make which way to go choices, which reveal more map pieces, loot to collect, and monsters to fight. The game features many fantasy RPG tropes, and I think it's going to appeal to anyone who's nostalgic about the old books. If you haven't played the old books, it might fall flat. I don't know. I know for me, there was a nostalgia thing there, and I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the final version of this game. From what I hear, quite a bit has changed. A lot from what we saw, to the point that like the publisher was like, okay, stop sharing pictures because they no longer apply anymore. So I don't know. It'll be interesting what it was. The big thing here that I think is going to be a big deciding factor is this, just like the books, technically has permadeath. You can go the wrong way and just boom, you fell in a pit and you're dead. And for fans of the books, they're like, yes, exactly. And then I flip back to the last spot, right? That's now in a board game format. And I don't know if people are going to take it as well in this format.
Yeah, it was fun, but I don't have the nostalgia for the IP. And so I think that did definitely temper it some. That being said, I think a lot of the real fantasy dungeon crawling people are probably going to like this anyway, even if you don't have the memory of the original content, because it really just is a good dungeon crawl. So my next one is Sanctums, called by some Diablo the board game. As a longtime Diablo fan, I don't know if I fully agree that it's Diablo the board game. Still, there is a lot of that styling to it, even if the feel isn't quite right. As a Euro, it does feel a bit sometimes much too much like multiplayer solitaire. You're engaged in more of a race than a battle with each other, for certain. But if you're all right with that limitation, this is a good solid dungeon crawl loot haul game with a big baddie at the end. Now, as a bonus, there are some nice minis if you're looking for some characters to paint.
Yeah, that one's interesting. I don't know. It's so odd. Like they did the tons of loot part of Diablo and the hordes of monsters, but it just doesn't feel like you're slaying anything. And then the end game is just so different from the rest of the game. It feels like you're playing a totally separate game. I don't know. I liked it, but even once I knew what it was, I just like, there's only four characters. They have the same skills every game. You're probably going to level them up in pretty close to the same order because the order just makes sense. And while there's a ton of monsters to fight, they're all just the same graphics with different color gems, red, green, and blue versions of the same. And then when you kill them, you get all these different pieces of gear. Each has its own unique art, which is really impressive. But it's like, it's a sword that does plus one. It's a sword that does minus one. It's a sword that does plus or minus one. It's a sword that does plus one and gives you a, like, it just, there wasn't enough variety. Now, I will say I do like the mechanics in this. It's very much that king me, roll for it mechanic of rolling dice and placing them on the cards to do things. And this is the best game I played that uses that mechanic. I love that dice system, but I don't know if it fits in a Diablo game. So that's 5 from each of us. So 15 fantasy game recommendations total. Should be more than enough to start a shopping list for someone who's looking to pick up some fantasy games.
Before we stop in the lobby to see what the cardboard connoisseurs have to add, we do have some honorable mentions. 3 games you'll have a very hard time finding, and one that's not available yet. But first, I need to nominate Zensu. No? Okay, how about Xylitar, which has the craziest fantasy background story I've ever heard of? No. The actual one I'm here to talk about is Shadows Over Camelot from Days of Wonder. One of the first cooperative board games and one of the first to introduce the concept of a hidden traitor. This Arthurian game continues to be a favorite of ours with its mix of clever card play and light RPG elements.
All right, well, I've got Tales of Arabian Nights. This adventure game from Zedman is pretty much legendary at this point, a game that's way more about the experience than trying to win. Wander around and experience the world of Arabia as told by Scheherazade. Interestingly, this one is coming back and tied to our last honorable mention. WizKids this year is releasing Tales of the Arthurian Knights, something we're hoping to get a peek at Origins.
Yeah, I'm so on the fence about that. Tales of the Arabian Knights is just so fanciful, and I just don't see Arthurian being able to be that out there, I guess, is the best way I can think of to word this. We'll see. Maybe they've done a fantastic job.
I'm sorry. That's another one that's on the Sean Must Play list. You're not well enough read in the Arthurian legends if you don't think they can be out there. That's all I'm gonna say.
Yeah, I'm kind of with you on that one.
Like the story of the 1001 Arabian Nights, there's an awful lot of messed up stuff in there.
Oh, there's some pretty messed up stuff in the Arthurian legends too,
let me tell you. Talking about 8 ancient legends, I'm pretty sure Hyperborea fits there as well. Though this one you can still find, despite being out of print. And I think that's due to the Dungeon Lords problem. The box cover here looks like a super dungeon crawler that even gives kind of a gauntlet feel, because you've got like a fighter, a mage, an archer, and like one's red, green, and blue, and they're color coded. And it looks like this huge, I'm going to go in a dungeon, kill monsters. But that's not this game at all. This is a I don't know. It kind of looks like an adventure game like Talisman 2, but it's not. It's an area control hex based euro that uses bag building really well, where you pull cubes out of your bag based on how leveled up your character is, and then place those cubes on your board to take actions like moving your armies and exploring ruins. I really like Hyperborea. If you can find the expansion, it's even better. All we've been able to do is play with a print and play version of the expansion because it's so hard to find. I'd still dig Hyperborea. I think it's really good. If you like area control, folk on a map games with a fantasy theme, shop around, because you can still find Hyperborea sometimes dirt cheap because new old stock. People are looking to get rid of it.
Our last honorable mention is also from Asmodee and Equinox, and that's soon to be released collectible card game Altered. I haven't been this hyped for a collectible game in a long time. We demoed it at Gamma Expo and it had us hooked. This is a two-player card game that's very different from your usual dueling game, featuring classic fairy tale and folklore characters and their companions who are working to meet up at the end of their journey.
All right, well, that's it for our fantasy game recommendations. But while we were sharing our favorite fantasy games, the lobby has been busy shouting out some of theirs. So these include Roger, says, just Fractured Sky was really fun.
That one I don't know offhand.
No, I don't know that one.
Roger is asking, would Blood Rage be considered fantasy? And I think so, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah,
and a lot of the lists I saw online included that one as well. Eggman Jr. is asking about Townfolk Tussle.
Again, I don't think you have the fantasy, do you? Like, is there magic? Again, that's your question.
Yeah, I think that one comes off as fantasy looking. It's got the look, but nothing else really to make it fantasy. Eggman saying the Reckoners would be urban fantasy, and
there you go. There's an urban fantasy game for you to check out.
There you go.
And Tex asking, would Quad Heroes be a fantasy game?
I don't know what else I'd qualify it as. It's almost like a cartoon game, like cartoon fantasy. Like it's almost like a different. Yeah, that one's rough. Yes, because I don't know where else I put it. It's not sci-fi. It's not horror. It's not urban fantasy. It's not historic. It's not modern. Yeah, I guess it would.
There we go. Ryan's got a few here for us. Descent Journeys in the Dark, first edition.
Yep.
Defenders of the Realm.
That one's, yeah, yeah.
You're killing dragons. Dungeon Lords, we already covered, and Valeria Card Kings, we have covered as well, with Roger throwing in Dungeon Pets.
See, I have not tried that. Everyone tells me it's a simpler version of Dungeon Lords, and I love Dungeon Lords. So I'm kind of like, why would I play Dungeon Pets if I can play Dungeon Lords? Sure. Well, I should try it sometime. Maybe it'll be like scratch the itch thing. Excuse me.
Eggman Jr. throws in an Oathsworn is my favorite fantasy campaign boss battler with a story campaign that precedes each battle.
Okay, Townsfolk Tussle, you can find an old jalopy. There's a car in it. It's not fantasy.
Fair. There we go.
Unless the car has feathered wings and fairies riding in the back.
No, it's an obstacle. I don't know. The game looks interesting. I hadn't really looked into it before. Oathsworn does look good. Thinking of Oathsworn, it makes me wonder what it's not, because there's machines, but I'd be hard pressed not to call Horizon Zero Dawn fantasy.
Yeah,
that one. Well, again, that's sort of a future past mix thing that gets into the whole Star Wars.
For sure. You know, science fiction.
Yeah, it's a science fantasy.
The Lords of Waterdeep meeples are indeed an awesome upgrade, yes. And I think they really fix the whole abstract cube problem, but Sean argues otherwise.
See, I don't know, it still feels like D&D to me, because D&D is not just about combat. It's the backstabbing, and you're trying to work for the lord of the city, and you're playing intrigue cards on other people, yeah. And you're manipulating heroes to go out and complete quests for you.
And I love the quest cards. I love the quest cards in that game. So,
tame owl bears. Come on, you send a bunch of heroes, stupid heroes, to go tame an owl bear for you.
Eggman points out that Sanctum could use an expansion that provides an alternate end game.
Yeah. Yeah, besides two separate games.
Yeah, I get where everyone's coming from on that. Absolutely.
I would buy that. I agree.
And Ryan throws in Mice and Mystics.
We debated that one on our list. We did talk about that quite a bit. I need to play it again. I need to break it out. Heck, the kids. No, I don't think our kids are too old. They love that kind of fantasy. It definitely fits. It definitely qualifies. So the reason we didn't put it on is we never finished. We played it with our kids when they were too young, and I think we only got three scenarios in. So I don't want to recommend a game that might have a terrible ending, or like there might be something where the whole thing falls off a cliff eventually. And I don't know, because we haven't played that far.
We were talking it out. We went back and checked and realized we hadn't played it since 2016. And yes, that was Mo's argument for not including it. And I was like, all right.
All right. And then not using the hashtag, but still thrown in there, Orion has brought up Hellbringer, where the pledge manager will be closing at the end of the month. And Charlie Brown
I've been looking for an update, and one just came out like yesterday or today. I was like, oh, good. Good to see that still going.
And Charlie Brown mentions Too Many Bones, which I think falls cleanly into it. So thanks, everyone, for coming out. And thanks for using hashtag ask in our recommendation. I think this worked out really nicely. I think we're going to be using this more going forward.